From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
This piece, Habitat, was written for the 35th anniversary of the East Building of the National Gallery of Art, and was also part of the 65th Annual Music Festival. And this came about because I had created a concert for the 70th anniversary of the West Building of the National Gallery, and the gallery asked me to compose a new piece for the 35th anniversary of the East Building. And knowing the space very well, I immediately thought about a piece I had conceived of around 2005 that involved a percussionist wandering through a kind of spiral galaxy of percussion instruments. And as he moved through these instruments, more and more technology was added to the piece to add certain levels of complexity. And the piece kind of laid dormant for several years, but when I was invited to create this piece for the East Building, to create a piece, I immediately thought of Habitat. And William and Ross and I sat down for about 2.5 years and mapped out all parts of it, and thought out strategy of how to create the piece. And as I said, I'm going to tell you a little bit about the composition components of it. I'm going to talk specifically about four parts, what I refer to as transformations, the architecture and space, the percussionist path, and finally score design, structure, and time. And these were the four elements of the composition that I decided were critical to make, to realize this piece, to make it into what I was thinking. So first of all, transformation. I was thinking about three elements that were important to make the concept of transformation happen. First of all, thinking of music as an abstract language. It's unique in that it can create abstract images for the listening audience. Then the second is the transformational power of music. And the third is music as sound composed across a time canvas. And I'll talk more about the third one in detail toward the end of my talk. So first of all, music as a singular abstract language. I've always been fascinated by the abstractness of music. You can make it be whatever you want, and different people perceive what you create differently. And music is not like words and speech. You need to be able to comprehend what someone is saying in order to have a conversation with them. As an example, if you are having a conversation with someone, if someone is speaking to you in a foreign language and you don't speak that language, you can't comprehend what they're telling you. Whereas with music, you, in order to understand it at a very high level, you generally are trained in some way as a musician. But that might not affect your enjoyment or appreciation of music. You don't have to be trained as a musician to understand it or enjoy it or get pleasure out of it. So because of its abstract nature, you can do a lot of things with music that can be appreciated, hopefully, by a wider range of people. And for me, all art has to be transformational in some way. That's the real power behind art and the power behind music. And what I was attempting to do with Habitat is to use the performance space to blend acoustic sounds of instrument of the percussion instruments, technology, and the architecture of the space to create a transformational effect. And I wanted to do this not just for the person, the audience listening, but for the percussionist as well. So in Habitat, the performer goes through this transformational journey, which I'll describe in a little bit, but it also is one that hopefully the audience enjoys as well. And this element of music composed across a time canvas is one that is very important to me. All of my music is very deliberately mapped out, and I'll show you some examples later. And it is very specific in terms of the timings and how it's performed. Even when there are aleatoric sections of it, there are boundary conditions that the performer has to adhere to in order to play that part. After I thought about all of these transformative forces for Habitat, I came up with this, what I refer to as the Habitat Transformation Algorithm, and it consisted of three parts: the composer, the percussionist, the computer musician, and architecture. So each of these characters has a unique role to play. The composer creates the source material or the seed idea. And essentially the composer puts all of this on paper and designs the entire piece. But it's the percussionist in this case who makes the piece come alive. The percussionist realizes these black smudges on these dots on a piece of paper. So it's critical for the percussionist to be able to sort of own the piece and give life to what the composer puts on paper. In the case of Habitat and all other computer music, the role of the computer musician is opens up a new threshold where new sounds are created and ideas that the composer has and that the percussionist performs are taken to a new level. And with Habitat, the percussionist acts as a trigger for some of these sounds, and the computer musician, in this case William Brent, modifies the incoming sounds and also generates some new sounds for the piece. And all of this happens within the context of the architecture of a space. And in the east building of the National Gallery, there is voluminous space. It's really an extraordinary place to perform a piece of music. And I have some pictures that I'll show you later of the layout. And so our challenge was to put all of these pieces together and make them coherent inside a monstrously huge architectural space. So that leads me to this part, architecture and spaces. This is the east building of the east building atrium of the National Gallery of Art, And if you've never been there, it's really an extraordinary place to visit, and it's a fabulous place for art. And we were very privileged to be able to present to premiere Habitat in this beautiful space, and to be allowed to explore the sonic possibilities in the atrium. So knowing that we were going to present Habitat in the atrium, I felt what needed to happen is that we needed to create a sonic ecosystem. And I developed a set of parameters that that we needed to explore to make this happen. And the first was thinking about the architecture of the space as a kind of inverted sculpture. And when we presented Habitat, we had multiple workstations, performance space stations, as you see here. And these worked beautifully in the atrium. They looked like pieces of artwork, sculptures that were inside the atrium. So we also, I have done a number of performances inside the atrium, and I was, I spent a lot of time before the performance of Habitat and before composing it, listening to the space, walking around the space, actually bringing speakers into various places and corners of the space and projecting sound to find out what it sounded like in all of the various spaces and areas of the atrium. And I also recognized that there would be two kinds of participants in this, the creators, that is William Ross and I in this case, and the audience. And what we needed to do was to shape a unifying experience through our creativity and connect with the audience and have them go on this journey with the percussionist. So this is just a kind of shopping list of things that I was thinking about for the creative side of this. I won't go through this list, but you can take a quick look at them. And they're very ordinary things like being concerned about speaker placement, the movement of the performer through the space, but also a more important one was auditory spatial awareness. That is, the three of us spent time in the space thinking about how to set things up and what would work best for the performance. Also, the final one, vertical and horizontal and surround sound, was very important. We weren't thinking of this in terms of a traditional performance in a space like this where sound is projected right at the audience, but rather we wanted to surround the audience with sound. We wanted sound to be able to move vertically as well as move at the audience. And the audience's role was obviously a lot more static. We wanted to have the audience respond to the performance, and some performances I've done in the atrium, we've actually asked the audience to move around to listen to the performance from different perspectives. And so the audience is inhabits the sound space, and that was one very important goal for us. We wanted the audience to feel like they were within this massive instrument that we were creating. And so I recognized that the best way to do this was to have a solo performer, not to write a piece for multiple performers, because I wanted the focus of the audience, the listener, to be on one performer's journey so that they always knew that sound was either being triggered in some way or created by the percussionist or by some processing that's being done to that that performer. So there were no perception that who was responsible for creating the sound and the performance. They could focus on one performer. And this idea led me to something that I call the multiplicity of effects. And I'm very interested in blending all of these sounds together. When you think about any performance, just a regular acoustic instrument performance, what you're really hearing is the acoustic instrument and that instrument in the space it's being performed in. And if you think about performances that you've heard in different venues, the instrument can sound very different depending on the shape and the design, the architecture of that space. So what we were attempting to do is blending the acoustic instrument through traditional performance techniques. You'll see Ross play these instruments in very traditional ways. You'll also see him play them in non-traditional ways, what we refer to as extended performance techniques. Then there's also computer processing, which will be very obvious to you. And then the effect, the impact of the architecture of the space. So this is what I refer to as the multiplicity of effects. Then finally, computer music technology. These are the things that that the three of us discussed and wanted to create, and William realized. So we were able to set up a multi-channel computer system, and it's all controlled through William's computer. There's also real-time computer processing that's happening, and percussion samples that are modified and advanced by William and played during the piece. And then, as you will hear during the performance part of this, there's spatialization control through the computer, but also, you won't see this today, but in the performance in the atrium, as Ross performed the piece and moved around the hall, the sound sources were coming from very different directions. So that leads me to the next part, which is the percussionist's path through the atrium. So once again, this is the atrium of the East Building. And after I decided that I was going to write Habitat, I spent a lot of time in the space, wandering around all the areas that you see here, and I created this diagram to to map out what I thought of as a spiral galaxy, where if you see down numbers 1 and 7, this is the starting and the ending point, and Ross moves from there to number 2 and 3, and then up to 4, 5, and then 6 is the bridge up at the top of the atrium, and then he moves over to the left side of the screen, and there's actually a hidden elevator back there, which he takes down to the floor to finish the piece. So I've got some images. Before I get to those, these are the 7 movements of Habitat. And then after between 6 and 7, you can see that there's a little prepared piano interlude, and I'll explain that in a moment. We're going to perform sections 1, 3, and 6 in a little while. So this is what the opening and closing section look like on the floor of the atrium. So Ross started out from this position, and you can see these beautiful images he projected. There were 3 projectors, one under the bridge on the left side, and then one on the far wall, and one on the near wall. And if you look in the far right of that image, you can see the third station, the flower pots. So this is the opening. He then moved to a piano that was used as a percussion instrument, treated as a percussion instrument. He's playing the inside of it in this section. Then this is a Harry Bartolius sculpture that was in the atrium at the time of the performance, and we received permission from the National Gallery to allow Ross to play it. And you can see he's wearing white gloves, and he has to run his hands across these rods. These are, I think, 17-foot long rods, and they made an absolutely gorgeous sound. And so when he was moving from the second station, the piano, to the third station, which is the household station, he walked past this and just moved it with his hands, and it actually rang and played for several minutes. And then this is the stairway up to the third station, the flower pots, and here's a close-up of Ross playing those, and that's one of the sections he's going to play in a little bit. Then he moved on to sound modules, and the flower pot section. He plays in a very traditional manner, but he's playing unusual percussion instruments. And in this section, sound modules, he's playing traditional percussion instruments, but he's triggering them in a very unusual way. You see in his left hand, he has a microphone, and he's playing with something called proximity, moving the microphone closer and further away as he activates all of these instruments. Then he moves up to the triangles at the highest point in the atrium. And here's a close-up of that. And so we had this issue of Ross having to walk across the bridge and get in the elevator to come down to the floor. And that took about a minute or so. So there was I wrote a short prepared piano part, and the pianist sort of snuck out from the audience and played this part while he was walking across the bridge and coming down. And you can, this is an image of a short moment where the two of them play together. And then he plays the closing section here. So this is a map showing all the different stages that he moved through, from the floor up to the stairs, to the mezzanine, and then up to the bridge, and then back down to the floor again for the closing. So knowing that the piece was going to be mapped out like that, I began to work on the score design. And for me, the two most important elements in creating a score are structure and time. And structure is important to me because it creates a set of boundary conditions that allow me to feel comfortable writing the piece and knowing exactly how long the piece is going to be, what all the performance elements are going to be in the piece. So I actually create very tightly controlled structures. We'll show you some examples of the opening section in a moment. The other element that's important to me is time, and being very tightly controlling of the time element. And these are two of my favorite sayings about the time element. Time is the canvas on which you consider music to be presented. And this one by the same composer, Elliot Carter: the really interesting thing about music is the time of it, the way it all goes along. And I feel exactly the same way about these. These are really, time is the most important matter to control in a composition. So one of the things that I created was a map that shows, if you look across the top, you can see these seven galaxies, that as I referred to them, and each of them have different sets of instruments, and they show dynamic progressions and all the various other progressions that are happening in the piece. This is a close-up of the first half of the map. And here's the second half, and I want to point out on the bottom this quote from William, that when early on in our discussions about creating Habitat, this is what William stated as his intention for the electronics and the computer part of it. And I think we really succeeded in creating that. So I have all of these, I have a map of the venue, of the space, and I have a kind of time map of how I'm going to move the percussionist through the space. And then I start to work in very specific units, something that I refer to as sonic units, and start breaking the piece up into manageable units. And across the time at the top, you can see the timeline for the piece. And I don't, when I say timeline, I don't mean minutes, or I'm talking about sections that I'm going to be working on. And then I've made a list of them in the center of it, and I'm trying to order them here in the lower half of it. And so from this not very detailed timeline, I start to build more detail into the piece, start to work on dynamic levels and what's going to happen with computer parts. And then across the top here, you can see there are tonal centers that I'm working on and I'm figuring out, and what's going to happen in these various states for the computer and the performer. And this is another breakdown of the opening, and there's a lot to absorb here. You couldn't possibly absorb all of this, but I want to show you that I'm breaking this down into more and more detail and starting to figure out specifics about each section and meter and important factors like that. And eventually I put all of this together into a very, very specific timeline that looks like this. So this is a timeline of the opening section, which is about 10 minutes, and it maps out almost every event that's supposed to happen. And it breaks everything down into very precise segments. When the computer is supposed to happen, when Ross is switching from instrument to instrument. And so it's a very, very specific breakdown of how the first movement is going to go. And this actually does eventually turn into music. And this is the score for the opening section. And each of the movements has a quote associated with it. And this one is from Steve Schick's book, The Percussionist's Art. So all the sections that you're seeing through here, the meter changes and instrument changes and phrasing changes are all mapped out in the section before. And so this is this is the second page of the opening section. And Ross is going to play this for us in a little bit. And so I think that we were very, very successful in accomplishing what we set out to do. And this is a review that Stephen Brooks wrote in the Washington Post, I think a day or so after the performance. And one of the things he points out at the end is that it seemed as if Ross is playing in the atrium itself as a gigantic meta instrument. And that was really my goal, to make it feel like the audience was inside this sonic environment that we created through the percussion, through the movement, and through the technology. And so Ross is going to perform these three sections from the piece in a little bit. So now William is going to give a little talk about some of the technology stuff. And I want to thank both William and Ross for all the work they've done today in making this happen. And for me, one of the most important things about contemporary composition is collaboration. It's really what makes very difficult music happen. It's what allows it to be realized. And I'm very fortunate to have two enormously talented collaborators in Habitat. And this really was a joint effort. So William is now going to talk about this.
Just talk a little about the technology design and management of how to control all these different elements. As you can tell from some of the pictures Steve was showing, there are a lot of instruments out there, but there are a lot of microphones, projectors, other computers that are networked together, so there's a lot to cover there. So I'll show you a stage plot of the whole piece in a second. And then I want to get into the process of how to design and manage something this big, because there's so many changing elements constantly that you can't possibly do it all manually. You really need computer power and processing to be able to pull this kind of stuff off in live performance. And also I want to say a little about how that impacts the performer. And then I want to show you the programming environment that the piece was realized in, which is called PD, which is short for Pure Data. And it's basically just a graphical programming language that's specific for manipulating media and especially audio. But you can technically make anything in PD. It's a computer language just like C. And so there we'll look at audio analysis stuff, like how to gather meaningful information off the microphones about what the performer's doing, different kinds of musical processes that the computer can do in response to the performer, some sound synthesis techniques that we're using, and also transformation. So those are kind of like the effects, like a wah-wah pedal on a guitar, a fuzz distortion, that sort of thing, but different. So this is the overview. I don't know how clearly you can see it, but these different stations that Steve was showing you in the actual images are kind of mapped out here. You can see that there are four mics on that opening and closing section here. That's what we've got set up here. A couple on the piano. There was a lavalier mic for the household thing, one on the modules thing that Ross was moving his left hand to capture those sounds, and more on the triangles up here. So all that is being fed into this central audio computer that's taking in all these channels of audio and transforming them, and then coming up with the transform result that's spatialized over these 8 speakers here surrounding the space. So we can really clearly make the sensation of sounds moving in specific directions, sounds, you know, happening in certain locations, and sometimes just having random processes for controlling the spatialization so that it's always kind of roaming around and never settling. The other main computer down here is the video computer that Ross's projection design was run from. So he created these videos. He's going to say more about that a little later. And it's really important, though, that the audio and video computer are on the same network together so that we can send information back and forth. So whatever happens based on what's coming in off the microphones can affect the video. Things like changing the brightness of the video with how loud he's playing, or when a note attack starts, a new video pops up, stuff like that. So those are all connected on a network switch, as well as 2 other computers for motion capture to track Ross's gestures as he plays, which can also affect processing. So a lot of elements, and it is all controlled. This is the terrifying part, with one space bar. There are faders, and of course, too, for fine grain control, but mostly that's automated. If you take a peek later at the equipment set up over here, it's pretty minimal, and it's just some faders that are automated as I move through these pre-composed cues that we worked hard to get just right. That's where I'll pick up to continue, is what it's like to be able to do this stuff in real time, and how that compares with the way it used to be done. There are some classic pieces from the 1960s by Karlheinz Stockhausen that involve electronic sounds and acoustic instruments, and they're played at the same time in a performance. But the big difference between these two pieces here, Contacta has a fixed tape part, so it's electronic sounds recorded on tape, and you just hit play and you go. And the performer memorizes all of these wild sounds and knows exactly where he or she is and plays their part tightly synchronized with it. And the result is really fantastic, because you get these perfect moments of these two worlds coming together. But the one drawback is there's no ability or leeway for the performer to be able to be expressive with things like phrasing and tempo. They can't, if they want to rush a section because they're just feeling it in the moment, they can't, because they'll be out of sync with this fixed tape part. One of the early solutions to that was another piece by Stockhausen, Microphony 1, that involves exploring a giant tam-tam with microphones, but also has an electronic instrument performer that is controlling filters, just a couple basic bandpass filters, but in real time. So that's another part in the score, is how to move these filters in real time. So that works out great, because they can never get out of sync, right? If the percussionist tam-tam performers go faster or slower, the filter performer can slow down too, and it's just like any other music situation. So The problem is when you have more than one person can do. If you have, instead of two or three effects, what if you have 200 effects? And what if they change much more quickly than any person could actually keep up with? And that idea was explored really effectively, and still is being explored, at IRCAM in Paris. And some early pioneers there were Philippe Mannery, a composer, and Miller Puckett, who's the author of Pure Data and MaxMSP, these programming environments for this kind of thing. And they worked together to develop a score following system where the microphones analyze what the performer's doing to see what pitches they're playing. The computer knows the pitches they're supposed to play, so if they more or less play their part right, the computer knows where they are in the piece and can make very specific things happen, tightly synchronized with them. And I've run, these pieces are amazing, and I've run the electronics for them myself, but I can tell you it's never perfect, because pitch tracking is not, it depends on the instrument. With percussion, it's especially bad, actually. And so there are problems with it, and you always end up having to nudge the computer part along, and you're always terrified that it's gonna, you know, jump forward five cues and everything will be out of sync. So what we've sort of settled in on is just something that's kind of semi-automatic instead of an automated computer part that just fully tries to follow along the performer. We're having me or any computer musician advance the score along with the space bar, maybe do a few other minor adjustments, something that's manageable so that things can't get too far out of sync. And we try to keep the interactivity level high by still using all that information, the pitch and the loudness and note attacks, to actually trigger events and processes so that the whole result still feels really interactive. And actually, I like that graph that Steve had in there showing the feedback loop between the performer and the computer musician, because obviously what Ross, the percussionist, is doing affects what I do, and vice versa. What I put back out into the space is going to affect his playing, just like you'd hope any kind of chamber music situation would be. So the next couple slides are just to give you a little glimpse into PD, Pure Data, the programming environment, which PD does nothing. You make everything in PD from basic elements, basically. It gives you basic tools like math multipliers and dividers, and you can manage control data for all the logic side of things and audio processing for the audio side of things. You can design your own effects. So instead of, if some of you have worked with digital audio workstations where you have plugins, someone made this plugin or effect and you pop it in and you can use it, but you can't really, there's a limit to how much control you can have. So the idea with PD is to be able to make anything you want from scratch. So this is a screenshot from the control panel for Habitat, and you can see the different little, these are called sub-patches. The main thing is called a patch. And if you click into any one of these, you get one layer deeper, and you can go as deep as you like. In here, the processing module has all of the effects. And this DSP thing has spatialization routines. This involves network communication to the other computers, you know, my basic volume, all the basic stuff you'd expect, as well as controls for cue lists, which are all the specific cues that happen through the course of the piece. This is just to show you, kind of exploding that other view a few layers into there. So I'm not going to show too much of PD. I'll show you a couple live demonstrations just a minute, but basically you're interconnecting a bunch of different basic objects and programming your whole system yourself. These are little screenshots from a couple, this looks like a couple lines from the opening section. So on the left and right are two different cues. You can see, like right here, I'm turning up the, or turning down the time stretch gain, one effects gain. I'm preloading a sample that I want to be able to play. I'm sending out a video cue to Ross's computer for a change in the video that's supposed to happen right on that cue. You can send spatialization commands. This is all just, you can make up your own language for how to talk to your system and reduce it into these basic commands, which is nice because if you need to make changes before performance or you change your mind, instead of having to remember anything, you just go in, like we did this just today. We wanted the release time on some of these sine wave generators to be longer, so I changed these numbers a couple hours ago, and we just made them longer, so now those sine waves are gonna last longer, and it's all really compact language, and it's actually manageable. And that means every button press when these commands are executed, it could be 10 commands, it could be 100 commands, but it's all instantaneous. I'll quickly say a couple things about audio analysis. The big things that we're taking advantage of here are spectral analysis or Fourier analysis to get the spectrum of a sound. And that can be done continuously in little chunks of audio as it's coming in off the microphones. You can just take spectrum snapshots. And you can use that information to capture things like attacks, the spectral envelope of the sound or how bright it sounds. You can also get volume, you can get pitch off of the spectrum. And I wanted to show that sort of in context here. So this is a PD patch here that I made just to show this. So this is me, there's the analysis of me talking right now, right? And you can see really clearly, first of all, this thing, if we go into the patch here, I'm using a bunch of weird objects, but this one gives you attacks. It tells you when there's been a sudden change in the spectrum of a sound. So if I snap my fingers, right? It reacts really quickly, and if I can make a bang, if I can make an event happen, if I can make that button flash, then I can do anything at that instant. And it, with the right settings, you can make it seem like as soon as there's a note attack, the computer does something at exactly the same time, or close enough to exactly at the same time that it feels together. So that's one thing. The spectrum itself, you can see from me whistling right now, maybe. You can see energy in different bands of the spectrum. And when I'm talking, you can see harmonics of my voice, which could tell you the pitch of the sound. This is the pitch over here. Right, it's graphing out pitch. So all of this can be done really cheaply. It doesn't take much processing power. Okay. I think the next bit was just to show you a couple of processes that depend on that kind of analysis in order to work. So these aren't effects processing the raw sound of the instruments. They're generative material that the computer comes up with independently, but it's triggered, or at least controlled by the percussionist. So one of the ideas that we talked about was this, we call it a gesture trigger. And the idea there was to get any short phrase out of the entire composition, which we encoded in a certain way that the computer can read it, and just grab a little phrase here or a little phrase there anytime the percussionist hits a note at certain moments. And that could be played back using any samples we want. So if we want to play that little phrase using a vibraphone sound or a marimba sound or a metal instrument sound, we can do that. And another one was that I wanted to show is the mobile. And that happens right at the end of the opening. We're going to do it today. And basically, as the performer goes through and plays these specific sounds at the end, each one of those is captured live by the computer and then just looped at a different spot in the hall. So it makes this collage of spatialized sounds that sort of accumulate as he plays the material. And we use that as transitional material between the opening and the piano section, which is the next instrument he has to walk to. So I'll just quickly show little examples of those. This is the gesture trig example. thing there is that it's not just the computer depending on the performer and microphones to generate something. It can sort of hold its own. Once he gets enough of those little fragments going and they play back, it feels like it's got its own momentum. And then that can start to create more of a push and pull between the performer, the live performer, and the computer. So that's sort of kind of like a little additional player. And this is the mobile that we're going to hear in a moment anyway, but I just wanted to draw your attention to it so that you understand how it's being created when we play it later. So you'll hear him play these discrete events and let 30 seconds go by. You'll kind of hear them echoing and still remaining and recirculating in the space. So at the beginning, there were other processes going on too. You heard a sinusoidal decomposition effect, which I think will be the last thing I show you here. But overall, that's the challenge, is to be able to make these different layers of processes happen, not letting anything become static and just sit there for too long that it becomes boring. That's the goal. So I'll finish just by showing you one more. If any of you have studied physics or Fourier analysis or anything like that, or a lot of musicians that get into this have had some experience with Fourier analysis and FFTs, you could sort of appreciate what's going on here, which is that any sound, I'm going to use a recording of Ross playing that we captured in a rehearsal, but any sound coming in live or recorded can be analyzed and broken down into its basic components as sine waves, because all sounds are just a big sum of sine waves. Even the sound of me talking right now, just really quickly changing sums of sine waves. If you have enough of them, you can perfectly resynthesize it. So the idea here is to analyze that using the analysis object, which is called Sigmund, which is supposed to be a joke after Sigmund Freud for analysis. And Sigmund creates, it gives you all of the frequencies, phases, amplitudes of the main sine waves in the sound you're analyzing. You can tell it any details you want. Like right here I said I want to know the 18 most important peaks, most important sine components. The highest I want to go is about 15,000 hertz, which is higher than I can really hear anyway, so I don't care that much. And then some analysis specs. And then all that information is being sent to a bunch of sine wave generators. This is, these are just a bunch of sine waves. In the end, it's this, an oscillator, just something that puts out numbers that go like that, right? But you can control the frequency and the phase and the amplitude. So this has about 90 oscillators. Here's the real sound first. I'll turn this up. And I'll mute that and I'm going to start it over and we'll hear the synthesized version of it. Thank you. tam-tam at the end. But for a lot of sounds, especially sounds that just ring out, like a vibraphone bar, it can sound really realistic. And for the triangles here that we're going to work with later, you can analyze that and get all that information and resynthesize it really, really accurately and make it sound pretty realistic. But the point is not to synthesize it perfectly, but to get that level of control and then do something unusual with it. So one of the effects you'll hear a lot is this, it's a set of commands to these sine oscillators telling them to start playing the right pitch, but then, you know, glissando and bend the pitch in weird ways that just make the sound sound like it's melting. So if I play that same sample with the different setting here, we can listen to that result. And I'll mix in the original too. Stop there, but all of these things, in a nutshell, just add another layer of expressivity and compositional intention, and it's been great working with Steve on this and Ross, because they're both, all of us have our foot in all of these worlds, composition, technology, and performance, and so we really, I think, are able to work together nicely and communicate well to do this kind of collaborative effort. Okay, well, I'm going to let Ross say a little about video here. Thank you.
Thanks, William, and thanks to Steve and also the entire staff of the Library of Congress for hosting this. It feels nice to bring the Habitat back to DC. In many ways, it was born here, it was created for the National Gallery space, as Steve described, and we've had other performances at the American University Katzen Gallery. And so I feel like this is the home, this is the origin of this piece. It's really nice to be back here. And my main role in this project is as a percussionist, but I also, from the very beginning, we started to design what is now a common term in theatrical and dance productions and sometimes in music. It's called projection design. A subcategory of that is called projection mapping. And the basic idea was to bring the sort of innards of this habitat that Steve created to a much larger scale. So the smallest, most micro grain, granular sort of element of the materials that go into making these sounds, the piano strings, the metals, the vibraphone bars, the wood, all of the sort of textures that comprise that sonic world. We want to represent that visually to allow a kind of microscopic view into the sound world. And what allows that is, instead of what we have here, which is basically a very presentational version of projection, which is a someone talking and projected imagery, we can design images that integrate into the space itself. We won't be doing that today, but in the previous performances, we've had that opportunity. And I want to show you a little bit about what that field is, not just for habitat, but for the whole world of theater and dance and music. What is projection design? I mean, I think if you look historically, projection design starts probably in the 60s for what I call integrated media or intermedia, which was a term coined by one of the Fluxus members, Dick Higgins. And right around that time, one of my mentors and collaborators, Roger Reynolds, created a piece in 1968 that was my first experience working with integrated media. And what that means is essentially what Habitat tried to do and does, which is to take various media components and decide how they will each serve one conceptual goal, focus. In the case of this piece by Roger Reynolds, the media were many. There was a Buteau dancer, text by Samuel Beckett, 35 millimeter slides, 16 millimeter film projection, quadraphonic electronic sounds, percussion, harmonium, piano, and flute. And so for 1968, this was a lot of cables and a lot of analog equipment to wrangle. And my experience with the piece was to bring it to the world of the digital and make it a digital piece. It was through researching this piece that I started to understand the process of integrating media, and one of the most interesting parts of that process to me is this diagramming phase that Steve and William both talked about. So even in 1968, these sort of diagrams start to crop up, and so that you see that composers are really starting to consider space as one of the parameters that's as important as anything else. It's as important as the melody and the harmony and the volumes. And so this is an example of a 1968 version of a kind of stage plan with the 16mm projector at the bottom and the two slide projectors in the middle and these two screens that represented by those lines, and then the piano percussion up in the upper left. And then what happens over the course of the history of integrated media, of intermedia, is we have a much more sophisticated way of managing these forces in the diagram stage. And for me, it's one of the most fun parts, is the creative part of thinking about how screens can be set up, what they'll be made of, where they'll be, whether we're projecting on walls or bass drum heads or whatever. It's a really fun, creative part of the process. So where this usually starts for me, it's the same for Habitat, it's the same for all the pieces I've worked on, is in a simple 3D rendering software. Sometimes I use this software called SketchUp, which is a little Google offshoot, to create rudimentary, three-dimensional, abstract representations, I guess, of geometric representations of what the stage could look like. And so, not knowing what all of these shapes mean, it doesn't have much meaning to someone outside the project, but this was a design for a three-screen system for James Dillon's piece. James Dillon is a Scottish composer who writes really long and complex pieces, and during the sort of premiere of this piece, we had to come up with this design, and it was realized in this form. You can see the three screens angled in the lower left and upper right, and then in the middle screen, there's a bass drum protruding through it. You can see the concept is here, and then this is the realization of the concept. So the integration of those screens is fundamental to the piece itself, and it defines the piece's overall environment and characteristics, and really sets it apart from a very traditional sort of binary of actor, singer, dancer, and screen. Instead, puts the actor, the performer, in the projected installation. And so I've tried to do this with nearly every piece I've created, and the Habitat is no exception. In another version of the piece, we often find ourselves requiring a sort of site specificity, which you've probably heard in the sort of description of public art, of site-specific art. And some spaces don't accommodate the same installation twice, and so I often end up reinventing this integration of media for each new space. This is another version of the same piece with the same musical instruments and the same sounds, but a completely different projection design that was more apt to function correctly in the space of this theater in the Netherlands called the BIM House. And the idea here was that the black screen behind the circular bass drum screen in the middle is actually looking out over the harbor and river in Amsterdam. And so these sort of sail screens become a nice foreground to that backdrop. So my main interest is in looking at the space and what the meaning of those space, what that space is, and integrating a screen design that's complementary or that's contrasting in a way that creates its own conversation, that makes for some sort of level of interpretation from the audience. In this case, the motivation was sails and ships. And in this case, the motivation was to recreate the dry canal beds of the Los Angeles River. And in the case of, you see here's the sort of behind the scenes, this is the back view of the sails in James Dillon's piece. Some other images from that same thing. One of the largest productions I worked on also had its origins here, which is in the National Symphony Orchestra's presentation of a new piece called George Washington by Roger Reynolds. And in this case, we converted the Kennedy Center space into a three-screen, 36-panel array of images that were scaled to the space and were designed to be evocative of the inside of the top of the Mount Vernon mansion, of Washington mansion on the Mount Vernon estate, which is built of these panels and windows and an octagonal cupola. So we wanted to expand that cupola and basically take the interior of that and put that onto the stage of the National Symphony's Kennedy Center stage, which I'm sure some of you here have seen. And that sort of scale relationship and the bringing of the orchestra to that landscape of the Mount Vernon estate was our way of integrating the concept and the media. And that's my main goal in all of this. A couple other images from that performance at the Kennedy Center. And the newest project I'm working on is trying to do the opposite in scale. Instead of big projections, we're scaling everything down to 2 by 2 foot boxes. This is the initial SketchUp, the version of the 3D rendering. And here is an early performance from March of the string quartet, sort of situated in this constellation of two-sided boxes. And the projections are mapped precisely onto these surfaces. And this is the part where the actors come on stage and they are situated also among these boxes. And the whole concept of this piece is based in the history of flight, from sort of cave paintings of birds to the entire history of human aspiration to fly. And so the images come from that history, they tell that story. But the purpose of the boxes is to create an evocation of box kites, which is one of the original ways of putting something aloft in the air, and it's also the original conception of the biplane wing from the Wright brothers. So that's the motivation behind these boxes, and over the course of the piece, that motivation gets revealed. I like that idea that the concept can be somewhat ambiguous, can seem like abstracted cubes at the beginning of a piece, only to reveal later that it is supposed to be a wing. And for Habitat, as you've seen many images already, the goal there again was to scale up and to immerse the audience in this world of microscopic imagery from the materials of the percussion setup. And so for that process, it meant mapping huge projections onto these facets of the stairwells that lead to the lower level and the upper mezzanine and the top of the escalator of the east wing of the National Gallery. And controlling them precisely with the softwares that William just described. So the scale there isn't so much about making my percussion playing and the body somehow related to the scale of the screens, but instead to create a wall of imagery that is all sort of surrounding and encompassing. For another performance in the Katzen Gallery, we didn't have that luxury of creating such scales. So for that, we actually went the opposite direction. We created object-like projections onto the smaller surfaces of the setups. So this is one of the setups you can see off to stage left over here with the flower pots. And below, there's this wooden cube. And it's difficult to see on this projection, but there are images precisely mapped onto those facets of that white gallery cube. And similar, this was a test setup of making sure that the images would map onto these other white gallery cubes that served not only as percussion instruments like cajones, but they also served as something that's similar and familiar to a gallery space, so as not to impose a completely foreign sculptural identity onto the piece. We used existing common resources within the gallery itself. And so that's where the piece has been. It's transformed from this huge immersive piece that was all about architecture and space to this object-oriented, very focused version in the Katzen Gallery at the American University. And here are today presenting a version just for the three movements with the live percussion playing processed through electronic sounds without the video projections, just to offer another version of the piece, because every space warrants a different interpretation. And I consider space to be the fourth collaborator of our quartet, and that it has just as big an impact on the way we configure this piece and interpret it as any other consideration. And so I think with that, we can move on to the second part of the presentation, which is a performance of three of the movements of Habitat.
Thank you.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.